The Story of My Mother Deer by Isaiah Drone III. The spirits of Marie Drone and Ophelia Johnson come to life by the seeds of love that they each planted in the heart and mind of their grandson Isaiah Drone III. In this book their spirits are awakened to tell their individual stories. The Story of My Mother Deer will draw the reader and the listener into the mind of women of old that refuse to let circumstances dictate their outcome. There is something extremely joyful about this book, and hopefully it will touch the mind and heart of someone like it touched me. This was my first book, so I experienced many obstacles and transitions. Now I have to be truthful with you, and the truth is that I have cried tremendously throughout this book. My tears have been by the puddles. My cries have been extremely loud, not for me or my family and our experiences, but for the pain of this lady. I saw her one day outside in the cold pushing a shopping cart. As I begin to write, I could see this strange woman walking the streets, and I felt that she never even knew who her mama was. She has been alone her whole life, and if you're reading this book now, I guarantee it will change your very life. Let's interject something to you, sweetie. God loves you, and whatever you have done or been through, He forgives you. So hold your head high and look to the sky, and I promise you it's going to be alright. I feel Him covering you right now from the top of your head like warm molasses down, down your back and your spine, and down to your knees and now your toes. See, we walk by faith and not by sight. Now dust yourself off. Sorry, I had to do some needed work there. Now back to the book. The structure or skeleton of this book is connected by songs and love poems of divine inspiration, expressing heartfelt situations and dilemmas that affect not only the characters in this book, but also the lives of many people, transcending over borders of ethnicity and cultural differences, divested amongst the children of God. These children possess gifts that factually are not limited to the world, neither are they limited to the galactic universe. Because they should realize that all things are possible to them that believe. Some of the characters in these upcoming chapters understand that philosophy of living and strategically moving by faith and not by senses. What I mean by senses are those things that are tangible by the five senses of sight, smell, hearing, feeling, and tasting. Because faith is the expectation during the process of wanting and waiting until the manifestation advances into reality that everyone can experience with the believer. This is why creativity has to occur in order for the rotation of the existence of living things to thrive in this solar system. There is only one Jehovah and one connection to Eloheinu, and that is through His Spirit, which is His voice that moved upon the face of the waters and said, "Let there be light," and there appeared light. The purpose of this book is for the enlightenment to be unto the mind of the reader. Also that information, understanding, and discovery be obtained to the sick, hungry, lonely, abused, broken-hearted, depressed, and lost communication of your family. The Story of My Mother Dear Ophelia Johnson. Part 1, 23rd Book of Psalms 1. He's my shepherd, for it's the Christ that strengthens me. He leads me to peaceful waters to restore my soul, enables me with power from on high that keeps me sustained to walk through the valley without being torn and mangled when I feel faint and fail to understand. He reaches down to lend a helping hand. He's my shepherd, I have confidence in Him. His tender mercies shall follow me. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. While I'm yet here, He prepares a place for me in the presence of mine enemies. Death is all around me, but I won't be afraid, cause if I cry out, He will save. The Story of My Mother Dear Ophelia, Chapter 1. Well, it was a quiet night in Collinsville, Illinois, and my daddy, Clem Schuler, was off at work as usual for the railroad company. On October 9, 1924, a beautiful African-American girl named Ophelia Schuler was sent to Clem and Dora Delay Schuler. I was the younger sibling to my brother Ben Andrew Schuler. My mother delivered me at the house because there were few hospitals back in those days, and fewer for blacks. Clem Schuler didn't see his newborn baby girl until he returned home from a hiatus from the railroad. the railroad was building new tracks in the southwest region of the United States, somewhere in Texas. Well, said Ophelia, Ben Andrew was only 5 when I was born. Ben was little to no help at all in taking care of me as a baby, so I had been informed. So I guess that's why he was so overprotective of me when I was older. Well, my father Clem arrived home to see me in mid-October, the year I was born. But he was too tired and beat down to spend time with me. I heard about the physical labor and rigorous travels he had to endure just to make ends meet for his family and all. But I heard my father was a wise and strong jet black man that enforced pride, stability, and education in his home. Clem didn't care too much for confrontation, especially with no woman. He wanted his children to be well-rounded and not have to cope with the treacherous work of uneducated blacks in the South. Clem Schuler, Sr. served in the United States Army during the First World War against the Germans and Hungarian Empire. His unit was the infamous 369th Infantry Regiment of the 93rd Division that was one of the only two combat divisions for black Americans permitted in WWI. Clem's division was stationed in France under the command of General Pershing, a man that did not support black combatant fighters or the commissioning of them to the officer ranks. I was told my father, Clem, landed in France in June of 1918 along with 19 other United States Army combat divisions, just weeks after his first son Ben Andrew was born. That's a shame they made my daddy go to war right after his son was born. Clem Schuler's regiment was called the Service and Supply SOS unit. They were mainly responsible for building roads, raising encampments, digging trenches, and burning feces. I was told that they pour motor oil on it and set it aflame while stirring it up in large metal drums. Ooh-wee! I know that they must have had to wear a mask or something to keep from passing out from the smell and all. There was a strong sense of discrimination in those days that left resentment and anguish in Clem's mind against injustice. He would later use that resentment to fuel his determination to educate his wife and children with the highest level of education possible for blacks at that time. My father Clem was a serious man with few words, but he meant exactly what he said and he didn't care what people thought about it. My mother dear Ophelia was told that her father Clem Schuler, Sr. died when she was only 12 years old. My mother dear Ophelia in her Early Roots chapter 2 in January 1935, Clem Schuler, Sr. received military orders to be stationed at the newly built training center, called Camp Joseph T. Robinson in North Little Rock, Arkansas. Clem requested that his family pack up to be moved immediately following his orders, because he had to travel to Camp Robinson with his army unit. After Corporal Clem Schuler was integrated into his gaining duty station, he sent for his family by train. They were to reunite with him in the city of Keogh, Arkansas at a plantation house owned by a prominent widowed white woman. My father was always traveling and so I never got to see him growing up in my childhood. All I remembered about him was that he always looked serious. Clem Schuler supposedly died that next year after his family was safely relocated. No one knows the reason for his untimely death. Some rumors have it that he moved to Guadalupe, Texas, working on a new railroad construction project for the government. However, a man with the same name as Clem Schuler seemingly married a woman named Maggie, with whom he had 3 children, Geneva, Clermy, and Maggie Lee. You know, I might have heard something like that. But that was just a little rumor. My brother and I were told little about our father after he died. If still alive, Clem apparently had his second son Clemmy in 1925. His mother Maggie named him after his father. He would have still married to his first wife Ora Dele Schuler when Maggie gave birth to his second set of children. The lifestyle of a railroad worker encompassed countless amounts of traveling abroad and living away from family, and the downtime was filled with gambling, partying, and having a good time. Some rumors surfaced that my father Clem finished his time in the service, and instead of him dying like I told to believe, he might have just relocated with the railroad to Texas to construct a new railroad bridge. those rumors could not be all true because my daddy loved me and he would not do such a thing. Meanwhile, Clem Schuller's old army division was making history by training some of the first African-American combatants to be implemented in the new World War II against the Nazis. There were many rumors of war and propaganda of communist views circulating in those days. The threats of attacks were imminent against the capitalist society of the United States of America. Nevertheless, America refused to be involved with the war that was brewing overseas until the attacks on Pearl Harbor. The year was 1941 and President Theodore Roosevelt had just selected to instate the draft of all selective service members throughout the country, forcing millions to deploy into the new World War. According to the gravestone, Clem Schuller was already deceased at this time. He died in 1940 at the age of 45. You know what? My mother dear, Ophelia. Yes, honey. No one really talks about what happened to great-grandfather Clem, which leads me to believe the rumors about him leaving my great-grandmother for another woman and starting a new family were true. Grandson, something's you just got to let it be. Ah. No, my mother dear, said Isaiah. I want to get to the bottom of this. You know what, I bet my mother dear Ophelia was probably told that he died shortly after his unit was sent downrange to defend the freedom of the citizens of the United States of America and their allies, foreign and domestic. Sighs. But the timeline doesn't match up. The only thing my mother dear remembers about her father is that he was very militant. Honey, just stop it. Let me tell my story, said Ophelia. As I was saying, yes, my father meant what he said and said what he meant, and I would tell your mother and the rest of the children in my house that same thing. Clem Schuller's old army support unit was one of the first to enter into the combat theater that took the most casualties by the Nazis' blitzkrieg invasion of 1941. Ah, you know what? Said Isaiah, that's when my mother dear Ophelia was probably told that her daddy was somewhere dead or missing and was never to be found. But go ahead, I'm done, said Isaiah. Clem's problematical work schedule provided him little time for his daughter Ophelia, so she never really knew what it was like to have a father figure in her life. The empty relationship she had with her father would come to haunt her in her future relationship and marriage to PVT. Timothy Johnson. Ophelia had a daily work schedule that was managed by her mother, Aura Delay Schuller, and it was combined with hard studies and household chores. These chores consisted of feeding livestock to picking cotton in the scorching hot and humid Arkansas summer climates. The countryside was filled with thick allergic pollination from the wildflowers floating in the air. Ophelia's childhood was filled with tough love and admiration, but it transformed her into the queen that her peers would try to emulate in the future. She experienced little of the tragedies that most black women endured in that period because her mother and big brother Ben Andrew were always watching out for their little Ophelia. Now, when my brother, Ben Andrew, left for college, things started to change for me little by little. I believe that I was about 13 when Ben Andrew was accepted into Philander Smith College of Little Rock, Arkansas. I was told that because of the distance between Keough and Little Rock, Ben Andrew had decided at best that he move to Little Rock, Arkansas and stay in the college dormitory. Back in those days, few automobiles were available, especially to single black households. Anyway, said Ophelia, Ben packed his things, caught a train to Little Rock, and moved into the dorms at his school. This move must have left my mother dear Ophelia alone to fend for herself in a town dominated by racism and inequality against blacks. Mama Delay, Ophelia's mother, would keep her daughter occupied by making her work at the local cotton gin company in the neighborhood. The cotton gins were oily, noisy, and the work was brutal, especially on a tiny little girl like Ophelia. The cotton gin was a massive machine that separated the cotton fibers from their seeds, making them easy to hand pick without fingers and hands bleeding all over the place. Aura Delay Schuller kept Ophelia closer to her side more than ever after Ben moved away for college. Perhaps, because there was nobody in that small town she could trust her baby daughter's sweet innocence to without jeopardizing her safety, said Isaiah. In other words, Aura DeLeschuler would kill anybody that even came close to messing with her kids. Aura DeLeschuler Chapter 3. The story has it that Aura DeLeschuler was a mean, tall, dark, witty, stern, humorless, and above all else loving mother to her two children. She was an extremely hard worker, so much to the fact that she impressed a plantation owner, so much to the extent that she offered her a partnership into her lucrative business of cotton production. My mama, Delay? Ha, said, my mother dear Ophelia. Child, she would gaunt and snarl at the workers when they were late, goofing off or lethargically moving around on the job. She was a strict taskmaster that didn't like excuses. Honey. And in Arkansas the summers were already hot and moist enough to make your nose bleed. She could really boss the workers around and still have the ability to lead her workers by example as well, said Ophelia. Aura Schuler apparently would make her demands known by shouting out commands to the workers. Like most women in those days, she could multitask while cooking in the back room kitchen, sewing blankets, and even cleaning her rifles on the back pouch where everyone could visually see her. Aura DeLeschuler seemingly inherited ethics, morale and most of her arsenal of firearms from her late husband, Clem Schuler, Sr. Being married to a military man would instill a strong sense of belief in authority and power. Yell, she used her guns and rifles to sometimes get her point across if needed, said Ophelia. Because her work ethic was in such high demand around the small town of Keogh, the owner of the plantation had no choice but to offer her pay raises. My mama Delay was promoted to manager over all the house employees and field workers at her boss plantation house. She was already responsible for keeping track of work schedules and payroll while she supervised and instructed different tasks for the house, yard, and field work. When payday came every weekend, she was responsible for divvying up the money between the workers. If they were late, they suffered a pay cut. If they didn't agree with their payment or they continued being late, they lost a job. Mama Delay kept it sweet, simple, never deviated from her policies and procedures, not even for her own children, said my mother dear Ophelia. The irony is little to no blacks was given the job description of manager by their employers, especially black women. Unfortunately, during the early 1900s, especially in the old Confederate South, the title manager was mainly reserved for white men. Aura DeLeschuler must have been highly respected not just by her employers, but also by other plantation owners as well. Aura DeLeschuler apparently was a perceptive businesswoman to actively engage trading agreements in close deals. She appeared to have made a substantial amount of transactions with the local store managers and traveling salesmen in and around the surrounding city markets. Mama Delay, child. She was a consummate businesswoman that knew numbers and how to make a penny stretch long enough to feed a large family. Mrs. Aura DeLeschuler eventually moved to an all-black subdivision still in existence today called Dixie Addition. This district of the city of North Little Rock, Arkansas is where she left her mark in black history. Dixie Addition is a rural area near the banks of the Arkansas River. The terrain features in this area are moist and mildly swampy. Aura DeLeschuler left Keogh, Arkansas, and moved to Dixie Addition of North Little Rock, Arkansas, and started a corner store business with the money she had cashed in from working at plantations and some of her small business investment dealings. Eventually, she decided to close the store after her daughter Ophelia started producing children consecutively one after the other and year after year. She was a hard-working entrepreneur before deciding to settle down and devote the rest of her life on earth as a full-time grandmother. Aura DeLeschuler had many obligations while still maintaining a solid family structure in the absence of a husband. She epitomized the image of a successful black woman with the backbone and structural components of a single mother living in America. She raised two successful children, a boy and girl by the names of Ben Andrew and Ophelia Schuler. Young Ophelia Chapter 4. Ophelia worked throughout the week after school and had little time for playing games or a social life with the neighborhood children. Ophelia's mother sent her and Ben Andrew to the best schools at that time for blacks. They were employed with chores early in life, and if they weren't working in the fields or inside the yards, they were studying. This technique later proved to be vital in the future outcome of Ben Andrew and Ophelia Schuler professions. Education and being self-reliant were the most important lesson that Ophelia's mother taught her children as a single mother. We had to walk to school every morning, or if we got lucky, we would catch a ride on a horse or donkey from someone traveling in that direction, said my mother, dear Ophelia. There were no school-sponsored lunches in those days. So Mama, Delay, sacked us leftover food from the previous night in a brown bag. Honey, y'all children today got it good. 'Cause we carried our lunch in that old greasy cotton picking bag that we would restitch every year to hold our food. Sometimes these bags even looked empty from a distance. But you know what? It was more than most children had. And we also found fruits en route to school that we ate along the way. This famous time in history was known as the Baby Boomer Era, which refers to the high birth rates in America immediately following the World Wars. These circumstances left many children fatherless. Because of the Great Wars and the high amount of causalities that resulted from the fatal aftermaths of devastations during the historical battles that took place, this era also birthed the independent women movement that swept the nation of the United States of America. Women in America in that time had little to no influence or rights, and many of their opinions would be ignored. The wave of this movement started with single and widowed women working in factories that formed the union to fight for equality and the right to work overtime and stand on their feet for the same length of time as their male counterparts. In that regard, Aura Delay Schuler had plenty of examples of strong single women standing up for their rights at that time. Ophelia's mother was so disciplined that the two children had no choice but to excel in their studies. Their educational upbringing provided them the opportunities to be accepted into the top black colleges. Mama Delay worked hard enough to put Ben Andrew through school to earn his Bachelor's of Science in Mathematics. Aura Delay Schuler's children were fortunate to have such a strong woman in the community that represented their race of African American people in the Dirty South. Ben Andrew's move to Little Rock took a toll on my Mama Delay, said Ophelia. Because she could not work at the level where she needed to be successful and watch after me too. She and her family became well known in the small town of Keogh, Arkansas. However, because of her situation at that time, it was difficult for Aura Delay Schuler to trust people, especially with her children's safety. For that reason, Aura Delay Schuler decided to move from Keogh, Arkansas, closer to Ophelia's new school, Jones High School of North Little Rock, Arkansas. They found a house in the Dixie Addition neighborhood located southwest of Interstate 40 and Interstate 440 on North Poplar Street in North Little Rock, Arkansas. This location is not too far from the main street of Broadway that runs directly to Jones High School. She chose this location because it was safe and in walking distance for Ophelia from her house to school. In addition, many black railroad workers were moving to this neighborhood because a major railway hub was located in the center of the community. Most of the black railroad workers and military men relocated their families to Rose City because Dixie Addition was the pickup point for train passengers. The Rose City district was a convenient area that workers could travel to and from work. The city started building homes, factories, and stores in the area. Small businesses were thriving because of the large families populating that area. Aura Delay Schuler picked a good time to move to this new district. While there, she also found a popular local church in the same community and became a faithful member of the congregation. Mama Delay always motivated me to think big and not small. You can do whatever your mind wants to do, she would say. I did just that and dreamt of becoming a professional secretary at the White House in Washington, D.C. when I grew up, said my mother, dear Ophelia. During that time in history, Washington, D.C. was tremendously publicized in the media because of the constant military operations around the world. The radio and television media were threatening that the invasion on American territory could happen at any day. The American people were antsy and ready to fight for their country's freedom and to liberate the world from the dictatorship wreaking havoc in the distance the lands. The classified ads in the papers and on billboards were asking for soldiers and secretaries to help the American people and to prepare for a possible World War II. Said, my mother dear Ophelia. These continual episodes helped influence my mother dear Ophelia to put her best foot forward in her education. Ophelia took her daily lessons home every day and though her mother was busy, she insisted on follow-ups about what was taught in class. Ophelia's teachers knew the seriousness she had for education. Aura Dele Schuler was made aware of Ophelia's high aptitude for learning from the teachers at her school. Nevertheless, Aura Dele Schuler demanded that Ophelia concentrate even harder. These studying techniques would prove to be vital in her coming years as a college student. Ophelia was 17 years old and at the top of her class by the time her high school graduation arrived. Heavy burden, another night of tossing and turning, day to day of mourning you cried sometimes for her, pleading to God, still waiting for an answer. Temperatures rising, eyes are watery at the point of combustion. Think it's all a matter of time before that piece of me drives me to insanity. God got my back, devil don't talk no smack. I am his child, I will not bow. I Isaiah droned the third. Miss Ophelia Schuler, Chapter 5. It was the summer of 1941 and records were established, some good and other bad. The 9th annual All-Star Baseball game just finished with Alabama winning 7-5 at the Briggs Stadium in Detroit, Michigan. Also that year, the death toll for Jewish martyrs for the month of July alone had reached over 18,456 human beings. In addition, the Tuskegee Airmen had just been dedicated as the first African-American flying school in the history of the United States of America. The America infrastructure was changing and at a rapid pace. The music scene in New York was even morphing from the swing and big band era into the subtle jazz style of laid-back and cool feelings of bebop, hard bop, and lush ballads. Like compositions, Round Midnight by Thelonious Monk and Confirmation by the infamous Charlie Yardbird Parker. The famous Hungarian composer, Bale Bartok, whom of which was one of the most significant musicians of the 20th century, contracted leukemia, leaving many fans heartbroken. These ingredients of pain, sorrow, and admiration mixed together can only do one thing when brewed together in a melting pot of inventions and developments. So people would celebrate at every opportunity given to them. People were meeting in small and large gatherings, drinking, socializing, and just plainly have one big party after the next. Ophelia and some of her high school friends did just that at the Camp Joseph Robinson Soldiers Club. Ophelia was familiar with Camp Robinson because her mother would sell merchandise to the soldiers on portable vendors on post. Ophelia would help sell items from time to time. This was a newly built facility, so events and promoters were constantly using this new hotspot to make money. One particular night they had an extravaganza where local high school and college students meet to dance the night away to local big bands and national recording acts. My mother dear Ophelia's suave charismatic behavior would draw attention. When she walked into a room, people literally turned their heads in her direction. She epitomized charm and beauty, and her dark radiant skin glowed like mahogany in a tropical African sunset with an airy mist in the jungle background. Said, Isaiah. I had just finished dancing some swing big band tunes with a smooth young gentleman that was just too polite for my taste at the time. Said, my mother dear Ophelia. When all of a sudden, hey, my name is Tim. I said, well. He said that he had just finished training and was gearing up to deploy to France. So I felt a little sorry for him, anyway, so I took Mr. Timothy Edward Johnson's hand and walked him to a desk where we could exchange mailing addresses. I became Tim's pen pal while he was overseas fighting. I believe the unit was the legendary Army Division Red One. PVT. Timothy Edward Johnson made it back to Camp Robinson on Summer in Our Time, where he met back up with Ophelia, and her brother Ben Andrew Schuler was with her this time. Well, Ben Andrew didn't take kindly to Timothy's rugged approach to life. Said, "My mother dear Ophelia." Not to mention that Timothy was not the educated man he would have liked to see his sister marrying. Well, Ben Andrew made his feelings about Tim known in the beginning, but I didn't care. I loved me some Timothy. Honey. Timothy received orders to redeploy. However, this time before he departed on his assignment, Timothy and Ophelia got married that summer of 1942. Sure did, said, "My mother dear Ophelia." Smiling. When Ben Andrew heard about this wedding, he became furious and it scared me. He sent me away. Talking about I could be a businesswoman if I moved away to Washington, D.C., there were many advertisements seeking clerks to work at the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. These clerks were responsible for letters to be mailed out to the deceased's family, and funeral arrangements also needed to be initiated by government staff. Ben Andrew seemingly tricked his sister by disguising his true motives and revealing the move as a job opportunity. Ben Andrew apparently shipped Ophelia off to another state on the East Coast, where she became sidetracked by work and perhaps forgot about her new beginnings. Ben Andrew Schuler knew the high demand for secretaries at that time. So he calculated the timing perfect if that was his plan. He was a very brilliant man. Ben Andrew Schuler said, "My mother dear Ophelia." Ophelia went for two reasons. One, it was her dream since her early teens, and two, she would be helping the man she loved more directly. Timothy didn't find out about her being moved to Washington until he finished his last tour in the Army. My mother dear Ophelia learned a strict lesson about marriage and the seriousness of taking those vows that would change both her and her husband's lives forever. Said, Isaiah. Timothy reunited with his wife in Virginia, and when he laid eyes on her, his heart broke into pieces. Timothy Edward Johnson from that point on would never fully trust Ophelia again. Before they returned back to Arkansas, Timothy and my mother dear Ophelia wept tremendously to the point of exhaustion as the two made a stop in Lexington, South Carolina, where they decided to leave some of their past behind. Where are you going? Get back in the car, Tim. Said, Ophelia. Loudly, Tim. 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 Yes, honey. Said, Timothy, Senior, baby it's cold outside. Said, Ophelia. Emotions. You're in love with someone who should have first been a friend. Stay together through thick and thin. Say that you're ready for holy matrimony. Overlooking so many signs, but your heart is blind already. No, that's not the one. Not the time for that type of change in your life. You ignored because it was them that your praise was for. Your emotions got in the way. Maybe next time you will obey. God is not a man that could lead you astray. Be careful next time, because you could be prey by Isaiah Drone the Third. Moving back to Arkansas. Chapter 6. The couple arrived back to Arkansas after Tim's active duty commitment to the war efforts was finished. His unit awarded him a Medal of Honor for his heroism back at Camp Joseph T. Robinson, where he trained. Tim's unit also shipped a large number of war criminals back to the United States, some of which were sent to his training post. In those days, they would often use military posts like Camp Robinson to store enemy nationals. They would house these prisoners while awaiting his or her trials. My mother dear Ophelia was home once again, this time permanently, with her husband. They were just like newlyweds. Timothy started from scratch, taking odd jobs until he landed a nice job working at the local Veterans Affairs office. Work was nothing new for him. Timothy had been working professionally since he dropped out of the sixth grade to help his family make ends meet. He grew up in South Carolina, where education standards were extremely low because the agricultural markets were booming and there were few schools for blacks. A black man in that region could make more money delivering hay, feeding cattle, planting crops, and picking cotton than reading books. Timothy was not a well-learned man, however, his common sense and survival skills were unmatched by even the most educated men, white or black. Timothy worked as janitor at the VA for over 20 years. The paradox is that the doctors at the VA were aware of Tim's ability to understand medical procedures. This was a probability because he loved to brag on himself to the point that doctors and nurses would challenge him with questions and medical policies. It wasn't all bragging though. He would treat children in the neighborhood and his church for deep cuts, broken bones, an illness that would normally require the skill of a physician. People knew he was well learned about medicine and automobiles because of his soldier background. Timothy was also gifted with mechanics and plumbing to the point that the whole community would come to him for service. Mama Delay was aware of his talents and took a major liking to Timothy and discovered they both had similar traits. My mother, dear Ophelia, said, Ben Andrew had just obtained a teaching job down the street from his university at Dunbar High School. Once school had been released for the summer, he reappeared on the scene to tell Timothy how he felt about him and his sister's marriage. Timothy's mentality was still shaken after all. He had just finished another year-long tour in one of the bloodiest wars in world history, World War II. My mother, dear Ophelia, said, PVT. Johnson had experienced everything from the devastation to a race of people to unfair treatment because of his ethnicity. He saw mass destruction in many forms, mistreatment, and embarrassment of his manhood. He would allow treatment to reside in his home. Ben Andrew dared to challenge this man's psychological agility and spiritual fortitude by telling Timothy he didn't deserve his sister. The only logical thing that can happen when you mix two combustible elements together is an explosion. My husband Timothy pulled out his newly cleaned rifle, aimed it at the face of my brother Ben Andrew, and said, "Now say something." Ben Andrew got back in his car and drove back wherever he had come from. My mother, dear Ophelia, said, I am sure Ben saw a side of my grandfather Timothy Edward Johnson Sr. that he did not ever want to see again. My mother dear had never been more scared in her whole life. Isaiah said, He knows all about your problems. He knows all about your fears. Turn them over to him and rest assured that through him we can do the impossible. He knows that you've been hurting for a long time, broken relationships, and down to your last dime are the walls caving in and time slipping by. Laying awake at night and don't understand why you're back against the wall, you begin to cry. He knows all about your problems. He knows all about your fears. Turn them over to him. He will do the impossible. He is God, the creator of the universe. With his voice sprung forth life, he is the wise omniscient one. Therefore all your problems he will overcome. He knew before time the secrets of your mind, yet he still died. So believe in him now. You shall receive eternal life. By Isaiah Drone III. Timothy Edward Johnson Jr. Chapter 7. In the summer of 1945, my mother dear Ophelia and Timothy found a beautiful home in Dixie Addition on the corner of G Street in North Little Rock, Arkansas. This house had a few acres of land surrounding it and was the perfect place to plant a garden, raise pigs, and chickens. This was a blessing because in those days funds were limited. After all, the Great Depression was in full swing. My mother dear Ophelia and Timothy were both working very hard during that time to establish and secure their new home. This new home was symbolic to them as the starting point of building their future family of 17 children. A bad wave of storms had just gone through the Pulaski County, Arkansas area and left severe damaged properties. So when the time was safe, Timothy and Ophelia quickly went to cleaning up all the debris from their land. Timothy was still torn about my mother dear Ophelia leaving Arkansas and being sent off to Washington D.C. without him knowing and especially without his approval. Isaiah said, they got in a very intense argument. Timothy started calling me names, and when we returned inside the house, my mother dear Ophelia said, in the confusion, I left the house and walked 1.5 miles to stay with my mama, Delay. I had the notion to think she would take my side. Boy, was I wrong. Ophelia revisited her mother's house for sanctum. To her surprise, she found no support, only shame from her mother. Aura delay Schuler scorned her child's acts against her only son-in-law Timothy. Senior Ophelia is forced to return home to deal with a seemingly outrageous, jealous, and angry man that had just left a war zone. He was still adapting to civilian life. She returns back home and again pleads for her husband to forgive her, and he does for a short time. The two newly-wedded couple finally sincerely make up and start to rekindle their romance, so much to the point that, "Yell, he got me pregnant," my mother dear Ophelia said. April of 1946, she gave birth to Timothy Edward Johnson Jr., made all things right again between my mother dear Ophelia and Timothy. Isaiah, said Timothy Jr. was a strong, bright and charming young child that loves both of his parents the same. My mother dear Ophelia is overly protective of him, not just because of her love but also because of the covenant that he represents to their family. Timothy Jr. conception made the flames of love and marriage grow stronger than it had in the past. Timothy Edward Johnson Jr. is the firstborn son and the first grandchild to Aura Delay Schuler. Ophelia taught him to cook, read, and write at an early age. His father taught him boxing, how to work the field, work on cars, fix houses in the neighborhood, and shoot weapons. Little Timothy becomes an extremely determined young man that is well loved on both sides of the family. He spent a considerable amount of time with my mama Delay. My mother dear Ophelia said, he learned many life lessons from Mama Delay about being respected in the community. Ben Andrew hears about the greatness of this young man and longs to get to know him. Ben Andrew would come to tears to spend time with his nephew on a one-on-one basis, even if it was to just go fishing. This was the consequence that Ben Andrew would always have to face because of his actions in the beginning of Timothy and Ophelia's marriage. Timothy Jr. became a well-rounded young man with the influence of his grandmother Aura Delay Schuler. Timothy Jr. attended the same high school as his mother Ophelia, and while still in high school was offered a job at a local bank called Union National Bank. He became one of the managers of the bank after 3 years of employment. Timothy Johnson Jr. impacted and influenced the Dixie Addition neighborhood thanks to the role models set in the place in his house and church. The bank managers knew of his influence and leadership abilities because he displayed it at work. He was responsible for drawing a large number of African American clients to the bank. In return, they advanced him to one of the management positions to better aid the company in customer service for minorities. His high school sweetheart was a young, beautiful lady by the name of Joyce Stewart. She was head over heads for little Timothy, but he was just a ladies' man during that period of his life. My mother dear Ophelia said, he drove a showroom glossy black 1957 Chevy sports car, all chrome with a loud racing engine that drove all the ladies wild in his neighborhood. Things were going great in his life until one day. He was pulled over on Broadway, harassed and beat up by two police officers. My mother dear Ophelia said, when they released him from the back seat of the patrol car, one of cops held him on the ground face down, while the other cop broke out his headlights and windows. That's a shame. My mother dear Ophelia said, this incident scared Timothy Jr. internally in a way that changed little Timothy's life forever. This was a psychological change about how he would feel about injustice. Timothy Jr. swore revenge on those two policemen. He wanted his justice on all the police force for what they had did to him and his car. He didn't want his parents to know the extent of what happened for fear of them getting in trouble themselves. In the late 1960s, the civil rights movement was on the rise and many black leaders were emerging in the major cities. Civil rights leaders like Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X were conducting famous marches. The Black Panther Party March of 1967 set the tone for black militant groups and street gangs to emulate. The Black Panther Party fought against police brutality, hangings, and harassment of blacks, poverty, and poor medical treatment for blacks. They had a strong racial overtone and memorable cliché like, Black Power recruited thousands of African American men into their organization. These men came from different lifestyles. They were educators, soldiers, entrepreneurs, gangsters, hollers, pimps, and even homeless. In the fall of 1968, the Black Panther Party started forming rallies in Dallas, Texas. Some of these new recruits spread their doctrines to smaller surrounding cities from Memphis to Dallas. Timothy Jr. started, like most of their recruits, reading the official newspaper of the Black Panther Party supplied, entitled The Black Panther. This was just the excuse Timothy Jr. was looking for to get back at the dirty cops that had beat him up and embarrassed him in front of all his friends and neighbors. Timothy Jr. and his best friend Alex Water, with the help of other childhood friends, formed the DP, an organization that was affiliated with the notorious Black Panther Party. They would meet after work hours to have meetings at the local parks or homes of some of the leaders of their gang. The members of the DP stayed armed everywhere they traveled. In order to enter into Dixie Edition, you had to cross the railroad tracks. That meant that you had to reduce your driving speed. The DP strategically set up battlegrounds on the entrance and exit point of their community, where even the police were scared to enter without notification. In the late fall of 1969, a group of police decided to ignore and violate the orders that came from the DP head chief and entered the neighborhood without proper notice. To those two police members' surprise, the police reports read, they received multiple shots fired from a bazooka. This incident didn't make the news media for fear that the message might send a blow to the integrity of the North Little Rock police departments. Instead, the police department notified the government and all the men of the DP were placed on surveillance. Lil Timothy Jr. and his friends became the most feared gang in their city. DP dubs Lil Timothy Jr. the nickname Crazy Man. The DP was soon placed on the most wanted list by government agencies. The gang became disbanded after the leader and other members of the gang were killed in cold blood. These events started a shooting spree with the police that ends with Timothy Edward Johnson Jr. being shot multiple times and once in the head from a drive-by. My little Timothy was rushed to the hospital and none of his little friends came to see my baby. My mother, dear Ophelia, said, Flower, the more I think about you, I feel so close to you. You're laid back, serene and intact. Is there nothing slacking or anything that you lack? You must be an angel undercover, cause no one ever made me feel the way I feel when I look at you. Your beauty is honest. I can't see my life without you. Flower, you know what I love you. By Isaiah Drone III. Lil Timothy's Angel, Chapter 8. My mother, dear Ophelia, got the word of what had just happened to her oldest son and started to pray immediately, and she encouraged all the saints at her church to pray as well. Isaiah said, the church members of Friendly Saints Holiness Church and Greater Temple of Worship Church went into many days of fasting and praying. Lil Timothy makes it out of the hospital room alive. I was at the hospital with Timothy Jr. every day. I bathed him and read the Bible to him, hoping that he would give his life to Christ. My mother, dear Ophelia, said, Timothy didn't argue with me. He just laid there on the hospital bed, his head wrapped up in bloody bandages and smiling at his mother. Little Timothy's father entered into the hospital room that first night shaking his head, but relieved to find his firstborn son is still alive and breathing. He points his finger at Timothy Jr. and tells him, Boy, you going mess around and kill me and yo mama, boy. Tim Jr. turned his head toward my mother, dear Ophelia, and saw the look in her eyes, and a chill covered his spine. This brought a tear down Lil Timothy's face, and his father started to get emotional after seeing what happened to his son. Timothy Sr., by charging out of the hospital room in the emotional rush. Nevertheless, my mother, dear Ophelia, stays at the bedside of Timothy Jr. whole night. Timothy Jr., admitted in the head trauma unit where he attended physical therapy sessions for months. Isaiah said, the doctors estimated that if he made it out the hospital alive, that he would have less than a year to live. They also estimated that if he did live longer, that he couldn't have children for fear of leaving them fatherless and his wife widowed. He never fully recovered, but before long, he was back on the streets. This time he was meaner and tougher than ever. Until one day, his little brother Chuck Anthony asked if he would pick him up from church after his choir rehearsal. Chucky was a musician at the church and he would often stay after church and choir rehearsals to socialize with his friends. Lil Timothy was always running late to pick up his brother Chucky. Chuck had already arranged plans for him to visit members of the church. They stayed next door to the church house on Valmar Street. Missionary Pyle welcomed her home to Chucky, as he would wait for his brother Timothy from time to time. Missionary Pyle had two beautiful young daughters, neither of them married at the time. Well, when Timothy Jr. rang the doorbell for his little brother, this angel named Flower opened not only the door to the house but also the door to his heart. My mother dear Ophelia said, the story has it that it was love at first sight for the both of them.